Yeah, welcome to our grand final edition of Off the Bench. Thanks to the TAC, drinking, driving, they are better apart. We have a jam-packed show coming your way tonight. We have a high-flying boy from Cobden now doing amazing things with the Bombers. We'll have a chat with him very shortly. We have our country footy roundup with Nathan Currie, our weekly wrap with Hannah Driscoll, our final GRV feature story, and of course our great country clashes. As I welcome the 97 best and fairest with the Cats. He doesn't like me saying this, but he was the red-hot favourite in the 95 Brownlow and didn't poll a vote. Welcome, Picks.
Oh, yeah, thank you, Wayne. Good to be. I'm very excited about this weekend, obviously. All the country grand finals, but also the Pussycats on Friday night are going over.
I thought you were talking about the Macedon Football Club, who broke a 41-year drought. We'll talk about that a little bit later on. You'll notice, Picks, that we have our blue ribbon on, and that's an important cause because it's supporting Victoria Police. Grand final eve, next Friday, you can donate at remember.org.au to support the amazing men and women who keep our community safe. So our thoughts and our support go out to the amazing people in blue who do a great job throughout the broader community. A massive show to get through, Picks, but the Bombers, it didn't finish the way that they would have liked because the Sydney Swans got a hold of them. But a man, I tell you what, that really announced themselves last year and has gone on to have a terrific second year has joined us tonight on the show, and that is Zach Merritt, the reigning best and fairest. Welcome, Zach.
Thanks, Andy, boys.
It is great to have you here, your boy from Cobden. And I did notice before we get into your AFL season, the Cobden boys went down last week.
Yeah, it's a bit disappointing. I went and watched Cobden play Currie, so Marty Gleeson and I had a bit of a rivalry watching the footy, and Currie were far too good for the boys on the weekend.
Bloody Spud Farmers.
You're from Warrnambool.
Well, they beat South too, so
move on. Of course
they
did. Now, tell us about your year, mate. You must have been really excited to have all those good players back in your group.
Yeah, it was just good to be back to being normal, I suppose, as a footy club. Being there for the first 3 years, it was a bit of a funny period to come along. But, to have those guys come back and have the leadership of Michael Hurley, Dyson Heppel, Cale Hooker and especially Joe Watson to come back was really exciting. And certainly as a younger player, I've really absorbed all the information they've bestowed upon me. And, it was just great to have them back from not only game day, but Monday to Friday at training as well.
You won the best and fairest quite easily last year. It was a brilliant season. I thought you were a little bit stiff not to be All-Australian last year, but it might be a bit harder to win it this year, even though you had an exceptional year because of all the talent that you were able to bring back.
Yeah, there's been, I think a lot of people have had some really consistent seasons. I think Michael Hurley down back was a really, really good season and was rewarded with a great All-Australian selection as well. So I think he's probably the man to beat on Crichton Medal night. But I think Joe Danaher as well is someone who has led our forward line probably for 4 years now as a young player, and he's someone I certainly look up to as well.
So would you wear that jacket maybe out in Cobden on a night out in the town at the local pub, local boozer?
I don't think they have blazers in Cobden, mate, but yeah, I might have to.
Yeah, what about the stances of some of these guys, Swanner? I mean, they've got the hands closed, the hands in pockets. You went with the one across the front. Is there an etiquette to it?
I think most of the boys in the front did go with the hands in front. I think Matty Crouch is a pretty relaxed character and want the hands in the pockets, but they look pretty funny there.
Well, congratulations. It's a terrific honour. The season, it didn't end the way that you would have liked, but given where the club's been and what you've been through, still to make the finals, it's certainly a step in the right direction.
Yeah, for probably that 48 hours after the loss to Sydney, it was very disappointing. But to start to review the season and look back on where we've come from, it is a massive effort to make a final in year one, I guess, in our process going forward. And I think so many players have come on so well, and Tip and Woody and Fantasia, to name a couple. But yeah, I think we're going in the right direction and have another pre-season under John and his new coaches is going to be really exciting.
What do you think you need to get from where you finished this year to where you want to get to next year, which you'd be obviously playing this weekend and then next weekend?
Yeah, I think we've got a really good spine, but I think we need to add probably to our midfield stocks. And you see with the likes of Sydney, Geelong, Adelaide, those sort of teams, they've got so many players that can go through there consistently. And I certainly didn't like playing the Giants when they had so many good runners.
You'd like to slide in a stringer there, wouldn't you? You'd fit him in somewhere?
I wouldn't say no. I mean, obviously, it's a long way to go in that process. But yeah, I'd be happy to have him come to Essendon as well.
I'll tell you what, Adrian Dodoro was doing a lot of numbers into his phone yesterday at the trade period launch, so you may end up with him at your group. I want to ask you about just quickly about McDonald, Tip and Woody. He is one of all the bad that came out of that couple of years of saga, which we call it Essendon, to be able to find guys like Fantasia, who probably got more games than he would have, and McDonald, Tip and Woody, what a find.
Yeah, absolutely. I think to take Tip Woody as a rookie, I mean, it's a bit of a diamond in the rough, isn't it, really? So the way he's played, and not only that, but I think Fantasia, the way he's led the club as a young player, has been something that probably doesn't get noticed as much as his on-field success, but he's someone who's driving the club forward, and I'm certainly glad that he's at our club.
You're a fine product of the Hampton District League, the Cobden Football Club, the names like Gary Rowan, Ben Cunnington. It's been a good breeding ground recently, I should say.
Yeah, I think Ben and Gary are probably the players that I guess have shown the way for myself to follow and probably made it realise that it was possible. Growing up, you probably didn't think you could make it from Cobden, but to see those guys go through and do so well has really gave my brother and I, and now Sean Darcy as well from Cobden, a real stepping stone to make the AFL.
You've been in bomber colours since you were a little boy.
16, playing for seniors, their picks at Cobden.
Yeah, well, that's what you expect in the country.
Yeah, of course.
Well, you would have played seniors at 16.
15 and a half, but it's not about me. Hey, that's mum and dad.
Mum and dad, yeah.
Yeah, mum and dad, yeah, they love getting down to watch me and my brother play every weekend when they can in Melbourne, and that's happened since we were young, and yeah, I certainly enjoy getting them down into the rooms after the game.
No, you're right. What happened last week against Currie?
Yeah, I don't want to talk too much about it, but yeah, Currie were just too good. They actually played very good footy and they switched the ball really well, so it was pretty impressive to watch.
Can Port Fairy beat them?
The Fairies?
I hope so.
What are they called? They're not called the Fairies. Why don't I call them the Fairies?
I hope they're Fairies. Seagulls.
The Seagulls.
Port Fairy. Sure, you should be
Port Fairy beat them 2 weeks ago.
I know they're not. I'm barracking for the Fairies.
Yeah.
Brad Shaw will coach the Fairies there at one stage.
I'll be certainly barracking for Port Fairy next week.
I think we all will. Hey, we appreciate you coming on and joining us on our grand final show. It's been a really tumultuous time for the footy club, but I think you and your teammates and importantly your supporters have been so supportive through a really difficult period. We congratulate you and your teammates and the club on what you've done, and we look forward to bigger and better things from the Bombers in 2018. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, boys. Thanks, Adam.
Here we go, Zach Merritt. He is a star, and he's got a great career in front of him, Pick. So why don't we have a look at our Carlton Draft Team of the Week for the final time. Victorian, born and bred since 1864.
Yeah, not my way. Horsham and District Football League. The Southern Mallee Giants. Now, fair to say they've got a few flags between the two merged clubs there. Beulah and Hopetoun.
Yep.
47 senior premierships.
How many?
Between the 47. Fair to say that. There's some of the legends, of course. Georgie Doherty and Lawrence Shackey, it's Josh's old man, the late Lawrence Shackey. And Jeff Burdett is a legend around the area as well. So
and the Giants got another one in the bag last week, Picks, with a tight win in the end.
Had to work hard to get there, but Harrow Balmoral not quite good enough on the day. Nice crowd there. I like how these clubs and the country clubs are starting to embrace the new teams in the AFL.
Yeah, I don't know about the Orange, though.
Well, it's pretty hard. You can't.
It's a premiership orange. It is. So well done to everybody there. That was our Carlton Draft Team of the Week. Victorian born and bred since 1864. Pick, something that really resonates with us, the community cans.
It really cans. Now, this is, we're giving away some cans at the following.
Crates.
Cans.
Crates of cans.
So Bendigo Footy League, Grand Final, QEO. Murray Footy League, Ovens and Murray Footy League, and the Geelong Football League as well. Carlton Draft, our great friends, will be all over it.
It's my understanding that our great friends at Carlton Draft have run multiple shifts to have so much product up there. So if you don't break for the teams playing in those grannies, get there because they've got plenty of the finest product going around. And of course, drink responsibly. We've got to take a break. We've got our Country Footy Roundup with Nathan Currie. Currie will join us next. Hannah Driscoll with our weekly wrap and a terrific GRV feature story still to come. So it's all thanks to our great mates at the TAC. It's our grand final edition of Off the Bench. Drinking, driving, much better apart. We can all do our bit to save lives on our roads.
From Channel 9.
Yes.
His name's Nathan Currie.
Yeah.
And he joins us now.
Welcome, Nathan.
Nathan on Instagram.
Oh,
now, Nathan's the kid there with the braces and the freckles. You won an award at the Drysdale Hawks where we're going to start today.
Not just one award, back-to-back best clubmans in under 14s. Thank you very much.
Having a bit of a kick.
This is a stitch-up.
All you had to do was hit the target. You hit the bloody cameraman. Yep.
Billy Joel, take it away.
You know what?
Look at me go.
In the words of Rex Hunt, he's got it. It's a cross between Michael Jackson and a cow with a cup of tea.
Hup, zip it. I haven't introduced you yet. That's our multifaceted, multi-talented, best utility back-to-back Nathan Currie from Channel 9 Local News. Time now for our Country Footy Roundup with this man. As we welcome Nathan Currie, welcome to you, Picks.
Can't believe he put himself a package together.
I did not put that together.
We've done this show for 10 years, Pix and I, and we don't get any packages.
No packages.
And
none.
While we're on packages, we something came yourself. Across our desk during the week last week, want to just back over for a sec.
This hit my desk.
Oh, boy.
This is, there's a couple of things here.
Now,
for a start, you've got those ridiculous socks on.
Yep.
Secondly, you're reading an article about yourself.
Yep.
Thirdly,
it's all a bit of a laugh,
you're quoting it. And so I'm a light reading. Cheers for the 3-page spread.
Yep. And no credits.
I gave you boys. I sent you boys a message. No, if you turn credits. The page, there's a picture of us three having a great time on this
apparently
desk.
Apparently, we couldn't get copies because someone had bought them all.
Bought them all out. That's the problem. Anyway, enough about you. Tell us more about yourself. Where are we starting? Where
no,
we
we're starting on
week?
Social media because we did send the tweet out to the flock. Give us the best grand final tweet. What did we come up with? We got something decent?
Yeah, well, a man by the name of Brendan Dix sent in a message letting us know that Carisbrook defeated the 4-time back-to-back Premier Navarre, but also Carisbrook's president and chairman of selectors on the Sunday morning flew to the ground with the Cups via helicopter and landed on the ground, which is pretty elite.
Who sent it in?
4-time back-to-back.
Brendan Dix.
Right. What does that mean?
Well, back-to-back-to-back-to-back.
No, I understand what four-peat means.
It's a four-peat.
It's four times back-to-back. That should be like eight, shouldn't it?
Why? It's four years in a row. How can it be eight?
Because here's the match. So Navarre was going for 5 in a row, essentially, because Carisbrook actually won the flag before they got on their run. So they ended up winning by 20 points there. Just a goal in it at half-time, but the Redbacks built their lead in the third term and then managed to maintain that in the last quarter.
Tim Notting there, I see, playing
possum.
Still.
Yeah.
The Possum's in there for 2 snags, but no win for Navarre. Very, very surprising. That's a very small banner.
Central Murray Football League Grand Final. It's still a banner, Pix.
Carrag's made it 6.
Single five.
10 grand finals in a row now. They've actually won six of them straight. Still a big occasion for Runeen, even though they lost. They had 7 teams competing across grand final day in football and netball, considering just 2 years ago their club rooms were burnt down in a fire. So even though they didn't win, still a big effort for them to come back from that. So big win to the Blues, though.
It certainly was. What about the Riddleton District? Tell me the Cats got up. I think it was a 41-year drought.
It was. It's insane. And they actually folded at the start of this century for about 4 years. They weren't in existence and they've come back. And yeah, really pleasing for them that they're able to get a win. The celebrations would have been massive there. They were out by 22 points in the second quarter. Then were actually 2 points down at half time. Came back to be 20 points up at 3-quarter time and then held on. So really pleasing signs for the Cats there.
Well done to the Pussy Cats. Let's hope it happens on Friday night against the Crows.
There was
real stuff.
There was 15 other grand finals played across last weekend.
It's huge, and there's going to be more this weekend as well. Birragara went back-to-back, getting over the top of Lawn. Warragul Industrials couldn't get the job done in Allan Bacon District. Bellpost Hill, they're a bit like Kerrang, they're just flying at the moment. The Sorrento Juggernaut,
yes,
in particular,
well
is, that just keeps rolling on. Witchy Proof Narrowport, their coach, became a father the next day. Hannah Driscoll will have more on that later. She'll also have more on Rennie. They got the job done in the Bacola and District South East Division.
Beautifully
you
done.
You mentioned the Dusties. Warrigal.
Yeah, on the Warragul Industrials, Nathan Ablett actually played in the reserves grand final. He kicked a goal, but couldn't get the job done in the grand final. He played one seniors game and played a few resis games. And your man Gary was there watching him as well.
Of course, he went down there. He played a few games.
Already packed
big
the
name.
House up and just moved down to Geelong again. Picks.
Wayne, you're so silly. But well done to Nathan having a kick. Yeah.
Take that to the bank. Gaz is coming back for the Cats. Hey, Chatty Wacker wins on debut picks.
It did.
Hey,
yeah,
we love
did,
a good red greyhound race. Right. What are we on? The black? The black dog?
No.
Go to the black.
You don't quite get the colours.
What do you mean? What do you mean?
The two down the outside, in the stripes.
Big comeback by the trainer too, Michael Brearley. Hasn't trained greyhounds in 17 years and then came back and took that
you
one
mean
to
the
a
blacks
win. So
the bibs.
Yes, oh, right. There's no big dog, is there?
Sorry, not a
no
dog.
No green dogs?
I've never been in the greyhound.
I'm trying to explain it all to you.
All right, we'll do that while we go into a great feature story about a father-son who have been involved in greyhounds and community football, involved with the Bunyip Football Club. Let's take a look at a father and son combination, and it is our second and final GRV feature.
My name's Stephen White, I'm from Bunyip. I've been involved in the Bunyip Football Club for many years and also involved in greyhounds for many years. Greyhound racing's a bug once you get it. you're sort of in it forever. Now, I've had greyhounds since 1982, been a trainer since 1982. So it's been a fantastic ride, and I hope it continues, and we've sort of still got more to look forward to. And fortunately enough, Michael has sort of said that he's very keen to sort of continue it on. So, you know, that makes me very happy.
When I was five, we moved from Brisbane, and we moved to a dog farm. So we had greyhounds there, and I remember having a pet greyhound, and about maybe 5 years ago, he bought a litter of pups, and sort of his passion for it got sparked again. And since then, it's sort of been, my involvement's got more and more.
It's like all families, we do argue, and we've had our moments here and there, but look, he's just quite willing to learn, and he has a great rapport with the greyhounds. So I think he's definitely got the bug as well, so he could be in for a long journey as well.
Little Vossi got through. Again, had a bump with Ellswick Max. They turned together. Little Vossi now asserts his superiority. Drew the clear about a length in front, and Little Vossi got in.
Yeah, we had two runners today, and two from two at Warrigal, which was an awesome effort and very exciting. Dad's always comparing dogs to, you know, an athlete or a footballer, and a good example of that is, if the dog's had three or four runs up the straight, is it ready to race? And Dad will often tell me, no, it's not. It's like you having three or four trainings and then going to play a game of footy.
Greyhound training and football, it goes hand in hand. I mean, if you've played football, you'll know how to train a greyhound. It will just come naturally to you. So the association there is very, very strong. Stephen's son is outstanding footballer, of course, as we know. Stephen, as a trainer, very, very successful. Seems to be a natural progression, I think. Putting in dogs, I mean, what can you ask for? Just got to throw in a beer and a meat pie and game's over.
Football clubs are a small community, and I think that's the same as the greyhounds. They're a small community, and look, everyone knows everyone's business, if that's a flaw to it, but they all seem to get along, you know, and that's the best part about it. There's not much sort of, you know, fighting, infighting going on. It all seems to be a happy family together.
One thing I like about the dogs, and you can sort of compare it to football as a sport, is that everyone's competitive, everyone wants to win, but after a race, six or seven out of the other trainers, they're all patting you on the back saying, well done, and that's good sportsmanship, and that's the same as football. I understand it's just a game.
Win, lose or draw, we're still at the bottom of the end of it, is we've had a fantastic day.
Yeah, well done to Stephen and his son Michael. Great story. It's all thanks to our very dear friends at Greyhound Racing, supporting 3,000 jobs in Victoria, as well as supporting every dog on and off the track. They've been a great supporter of our program through the year, and so have you, Nath. You've been a very, very good contributor.
Pleasure, boys. Thanks for having me.
And you'll come to Hillsville with me Sunday.
I'd love to. And by the way, I have been to the races. I've seen Bold Trees win two of its Sandown Cups back in the day with Norm McCulloch as the trainer. Hey, what about our Player of the Week picks? Who have we got this week? And it's all thanks to Dan Sultan's great new album, Killer.
It is. It's Toby Marnie here from the Inverloch Kongwop Football Club. He kicked five snags in the grand final on the weekend.
Seven snags, I should say. Don't rob him.
Seven goals. Sorry, well done to Toby. And I know you called him Mahoney earlier, but his name's Marnie.
Is that right?
Marnie. And his first name's Toby.
Yeah, no, thank you very much.
Well done, Toby.
Well done, Marnes. Great effort. And that was all thanks to Dan Sultan's killer album. We've got to take a break. Hannah Driscoll with our weekly wrap coming up next. Off the Bench Grand Final Show. All thanks to our great mates at the TAC. Drinking, driving, they are much better apart.
Delighted to be in our hometown here in Geelong today for a Towards Zero Game Plan event. Today's all about leadership and pushing down road trauma in our community. Tragically, outside of Melbourne, Geelong's actually got the highest rate of road trauma in Victoria, so there's a lot of work to be done, and I'm just really delighted we've got 200 leaders of the Geelong community here today that are going to band together and speak about how we can push down road trauma.
We have the Great Ocean Road, Princess Highway, huge influx of tourists over the, especially the summer season. Being able to have better infrastructure, better signage, better designed roads, it can also influence the amount of crashes and etc. So it's not just about drivers' behaviour, it's also about the roads, the surfaces and, you know, warnings to people. So it's we think it's very important to be involved in a partnership with TAC and Towards Zero.
So was great to work alongside Scotty Cummings and Ricky Ponting. Was amazing. So I think Ricky summed up perfectly. You know, if you can have an influence and let five people know, you know, then all of a sudden it becomes 1,000, and then they, before you know it, it grows, and it's that kind of pass it on kind of forward effect.
Biggest thing I learned was the actual numbers and the data behind what TAC Cup are doing, and trying to bridge that gap between driving less incidents on the road and back down to zero, which is wonderful. We have a stand together, which is sort of the brand logo of the TAC Cup as well, in bonding together to drive better decisions for young footballers so they can make better decisions on the road.
Welcome back to Off the Bench, and that was the final of the game plan series. Thanks to our great mates promoting the Towards Zero campaign by the TAC. Well done to everybody involved. It's such an important message, which we support absolutely. Time now for our weekly wrap. And that's all thanks to the Weekly Times, the voice of the country. We welcome back for the final time this year, Hannah Driscoll. Welcome.
How you going, guys?
Good.
We're going well, Hannah. Where are we going to start this week?
We are going to start in the North Central League. And we've got a new nomination for Best on Ground for the Grand Final. Julian Bull, the playing coach's partner, went into labour in the early hours of the morning before their Grand Final. Julian was able to duck off, go and win the flag with Witchy Booth Narrowport, and come back and welcome a baby daughter into the world on Sunday afternoon. So it was a big weekend for him.
Good set of guns on him.
Yeah.
Looking real good, Nick.
He's looking pretty good. So he's got a big sort of couple of days and a new bundle to manage as well.
Now what about these boys, the Falcons?
This is the Falcons into their first TAC Cup Grand Final for 17 years. So they'll be playing that final on Sunday evening in the big triple header with the VFL and the VFL women's games beforehand. And they had a couple of their most recent premiership players in Luke Hodge and recent Torquay premiership coach Dom Gleeson come and speak to them on Tuesday night. So building up to a big game for them.
Well, Mickey Turner will be very excited about it. A great Geelong man down there, the dashing women. Now we've got 12 grand finals to be played to conclude all the country finals across the state.
Yes, this will be the last weekend. Now, a question for you guys. Well, where were you in 1958?
1958?
Wasn't even born.
I wasn't born either.
There you go. Well, that's how long Port Fairy, you mentioned them before, that's how long it's been since they won a grand final. They are into the Hampton League final this weekend. So, and as you mentioned, playing Currie. So big game, and best of luck to the Seagulls.
We do want Port Fairies to win.
Oh, absolutely. What about our photo of the week? He's made a comeback.
Wrapping it up with Yuri. This was from the Allan Bank and District Grand Final. Katani getting over the line by 1 point. So congratulations to them.
Well done to everybody, and a big thank you to you, Hannah. Your contribution has been great this year, and it's all thanks to the Weekly Times. If you'd like to read Hannah's articles or catch up with the fresh news daily, then you can jump onto that website and follow all the progress there. We've got to take our final break. When we come back, Pickers is in red hot tipping form. Our great country clash is up next. Yeah, welcome back off the bench. Time for our final Great Country Clash. Who is it, Picks? Where are we going? Who's playing?
It's Gippsland Footy League. It's the Parrots, Lee and Gatha, taking on Mafra. Won all this year, 3 o'clock at Maui on Saturday.
Give us your tip.
I'm going for the Bo Vernon coached Parrots.
All right, we're on that. Now, quickly, Adelaide take on Geelong Friday night.
Cats.
There's a surprise. Richmond take on the Giants. Can the Tigers make the granny for the first time since 1982?
Yeah, I think they will, Swatter.
All right, thanks to you, Picks. Thanks to Hannah. Thanks to Nathan Currie. Thanks to Lachlan McKinnon, Tristan Fernanda, and importantly, the TAC Carlton Draft Greyhound Racing Victoria, the Weekly Times, and Croc Media, and our audience. It's been a great year. All the best, and we'll see you again next year.